Dick Smith, an Australian, setting off from Fort Worth in Texas to fly around the world solo in a helicopter. It's never been done. He's a self-made millionaire of 37, and the idea of the flight grew from the idea of picking up his machine from the works. Watching from the passenger seat is a remote control camera. Using it will increase his fatigue. For the moment, he's fresh and heading for the Arctic, filming and talking to us at the same time.
Well, I've just departed. Talk about exciting. A great send-off down there. And I've got all the television station helicopters staying.
No, he does not ever again.
Going to chase me, so I've got to just watch out for them. But I'm just going north for a little while. Just going north for a little while to keep away from the Dallas-Fort Worth, the control zone of all the big international aircraft and everything.
With special tanks, the JetRanger can fly 1,000 miles. Today, Dick plans to cover about 800.
Well, we're just at the Mississippi River, and here's a Mississippi barge. So they still have them, obviously. It's fantastic. I've actually got to the Mississippi River.
As a foretaste of things to come, flying up the east coast of America, Dick got lost briefly in a haze on his first day. Fog envelops him on day two, approaching Washington.
Well, I'm having the first problems of the trip. You can probably see it's, just hold on. Very, very, get that autopilot right. Very, very foggy in that, and I've had to divert around. You can just see through there how bad it is. The only way to get through is just to follow the highway and keep on it as close as possible.
From 642, you're clear to two.
Very, very bad weather. And now I'm just trekking up the Hamamack River towards Washington. It's very bad weather, but I should be able to get in. I can just see the other side. You might just be able to see it there, very, very vaguely. Still can't contact the tower. I can see some big high power lines coming up. I've got to go above them.
I started to get frightened because I thought if I end up ditching the helicopter and only the second day, well, I probably won't get hurt, but the flight, I can't go on with it. I failed, and that was worrying me tremendously. The next day I was so fortunate because the air traffic controller allowed me to fly right around Washington, around the monuments, not actually over the White House, but near it.
Ah, my apologies. We're ready to go onto our track outbound now, thank you.
Proceed on course. Okay, are you on an IFR or VFR flight plan?
On a VFR flight plan. I've actually found it. New York. Have a look at that.
To New York from Washington was a short day. 2.5 hours in perfect weather.
I dreamt for over 2 years as I'd planned the flight, I dreamt that I was actually going to fly around the Statue of Liberty. And to actually see it in front of me, I thought, crikey, I'm going to be able to do it.
Gotta just try and find this little heliport here, down here a bit. Get some fuel. Almost like going in a boat.
Dick has planned to rest for a whole day in New York, but is so pleased at his progress that he decides to press on.
Just been sitting here getting refueled at the pump over here, just signing this card. Yeah. Okay, good luck. Thank you, bye-bye. Just getting the paying for the fuel.
Flying a helicopter in New York was a bit like driving a car everywhere else. It was just so easy. There were special helicopter lanes. You could just fly down and get refueled as if you were just buying some fuel from the local service station.
As Dick flew north to Canada and Baffin Island, he ran into language trouble for the first, but by no means the last time. He found the eastern accent of the traffic controllers difficult to understand. Now, after variable flying conditions over the province of Quebec, the weather gets difficult.
Solid. I can still see quite a good horizon. You notice out there there's quite a good horizon. So I'm allowed to fly through rain like this, and I can still see the water down below, but it's still not that comfortable flying through rain, of course, especially with it on the windscreen.
I've landed here on the south of Frobisher Bay, on Baffin Island, I suppose it is. I'm going to have to try and camp the night. I managed to radio through to a passing aircraft, but that weather is absolutely impossible, and I'm, you know, it's really getting me down in the dumps. After coming across in all that rain and then fighting for an hour and a half to try and get up a valley and having just to put the helicopter down here and climb underneath the helicopter and try and sleep the night and try and get in the morning or whenever the weather gets okay.
Dick, filming himself from a tripod after 11 hours flying and a forced landing. He was running out of daylight and there was no visible route over the mountains to Frobisher Bay.
Well, I've been here, lying here actually, trying to get some sleep tonight. There's been lots of great big mosquitoes and everything. I spent the night. The weather actually looks good, just looking up here. And I'm going to try and call into Frobisher Bay. I've estimated I'm about 60 miles to the south. I couldn't sleep last night. There's huge icebergs crashing.
I'd visualised before doing the flight that all of the icebergs would be big and flat and I could land on one if I had an engine failure. But looking down, I found that most of them were all crazy angles and there was no way of landing on them. So it would have been in the drink. The temperatures were freezing, minus 20 degrees in the cockpit. Because of the weight problems, I couldn't take a heater. The compass was almost useless. It was a matter of dead reckoning and using the VLF Amiga.
I've got the aircraft on autopilot now. And it just makes it so easy, of course, because otherwise you wouldn't be able to let go. Mike, filming. This is you looking at me. There you are. That's what you look like. Well, I can swing this camera around. Oops, and adjust the height, put it out the window or anything. Just like that. VLF Amiga down here. And all the instruments, a lot of them.
As an Australian, we love desert. We don't see much snow. We love the wide brown land and flying over that incredible scenery, the ice floes. I just thought how fortunate I am. I'd heard of Sondre's Stromfjord from years back from reading about it, and to suddenly be flying down it in a helicopter where you've got such great visibility. You could see it was just absolutely magnificent.
I'm about halfway across the Atlantic Ocean between Greenland and Iceland. I've been sort of darting around rain showers. You can probably see down there, it's awfully rough. Let you have a look. Very, very rough wind. I'm bashing into a headwind, only doing about 90 knots. But that's the way it goes. The VLF Amiga seems to be working well. And hold on, I just turn to the left a bit and go around this rain shower. And this is the type of thing where I wouldn't like anything to go wrong, but everything seems to be working perfectly. And I've got about nearly 3 hours to go to get to Iceland. And Iceland is not in very good weather conditions, but I should be able to get my way in there as long as everything works well. As you can see, I've got the survival suit on. I've got a life jacket down here. I've got my flight plan, which I use all the time. And this is, I suppose, one of the challenges of flying over long oceans. It's a bit frightening if you stop and think about it, if you have to come down there. I'd have to grab my life raft, which is just over to the left, and jump out awful quickly into that freezing water.
The 400-mile jump from Kulusuk to Iceland was Dick's longest and most dangerous water crossing so far.
Well, talk about fantastic. I've found the coast. Have a look at that. Have a look at it. See it over there? And so I should be in at Reykjavik in about 20 minutes after that very, quite difficult sea crossing. Mountains up ahead straight through there too. Looks like quite a beautiful place. As you can see, the water's still pretty rough down there.
Just landing a kilo, there will be one aircraft taking off runway 02. Please arrange your flight source to cross the intersection after he's passed.
Roger, will do.
By now, on top of all the other pressures, Dick has the makings of a social problem. Royalty has agreed to meet Dick at Balmoral, and royalty doesn't like to wait. So it's press on.
Well, once again, I've got some weather problems. I'm trying to get up over this mountain range. And as you can see, it's covered especially this way. This is the mountain range from Reykjavik over to Hornafjord, which is the other side of Iceland, and it's got rain and cloud on it, but it looks as straight ahead I'm going to be able to go that way. That's the way I'm heading. Straight ahead, try and get over. It's going to be about 3,000 feet by the look of it. All lava flows here. Just a lot of it, more rain too. All I ever seem to get is rain. Then again, you can see very well, so there's no problem.
My idea was to fly across the Atlantic visually, and that meant following a high-pressure system and getting in good weather. Unfortunately, I ended up following a low-pressure system and getting into atrocious weather. And when I look back on it, I think I was very, very fortunate to be able to get away. I'd never do it again, never. I never really thought I'd kill myself. And when I actually got to Scotland, I think I was more surprised than those people that I'd actually got there, because everything was so indeterminate. I never knew what was going to happen. I suppose that was the frightening thing about the trip, but also the exciting thing, the thing that gave me the adrenaline to want to do it, the spirit of adventure.
Well, talk about exciting. I think I've done it. I've just sighted the coast of one of the Scottish islands, which means I'm virtually across the Atlantic. I'm very pleased. In fact, it's the Outer Hebrides, and it's the Isle of Lewis. So just see if you can see it there, way in the distance. Got to get some movie on. Hold on. Lighthouse is the actual tip. It's just called a lighthouse on the map here.
When Dick landed at Stornoway, he became the first person to cross the Atlantic solo by helicopter. He also discovered how lucky he'd been to arrive there intact.
By the way, we noticed last night, just see if I can show it to you. This hole here, I don't know if you can see it there, but there's a hole there which looks as if it's been made by a bullet going right through the aircraft. Quite a worrying thing. I don't know when it happened.
Actually, Dick found two bullet holes, one high up in the fuel tank. Probably seal hunters in Iceland, he thinks. He didn't report the incident to Stornoway police in case inquiries delayed him.
I'd managed to organise that on my first landing on the mainland of Scotland after I'd flown the Atlantic, that I'd be met by Prince Charles. For a second, as I actually flew down the valley, I couldn't see the castle, and I thought I'd made a terrible mistake, but then below me I saw the castle. It wasn't that big. And to actually come in and land, and as I looked down, I could see Prince Charles, and gee, I was excited to actually get there on time, to see Pip and the girls and to see Prince Charles. It was incredibly exciting.
He's punctual, so Prince Charles won't lock him up in the tower. So far, Dick has travelled 5,000 miles and flown 50 hours. The JetRanger engine needs to idle for 2 minutes before shutdown, so Dick has time to record his feelings.
Imagine that landing at Balmoral Castle. I've just gone over the castle. I'm so excited. What's the time? 9:30, which is exactly 10:30, the time that I'm supposed to be here at Balmoral Castle. And I can see Prince Charles over there, even dressed up in a kilt. Should have bought my Smith kilt.
Instead of Prince Charles just spending 10 or 15 minutes that he stayed around talking, he was obviously very enthusiastic about helicopters. I was incredibly excited to think that I'd actually done it, that I was the first person across the Atlantic solo in a helicopter. Just fantastic.
Dick's family are to rejoin him in London after another long day. 6.5 hours flying.
Well, look at that. I found it absolutely fantastic. The Tower Bridge. Look at that. I'm in London. Across the Atlantic and in London.
To me, having flown around the Statue of Liberty and then flying across the Tower Bridge, crikey, these plans that I'd made years ago, and I thought just how lucky I was to actually not only get across the Atlantic, but to actually be able to fly in and land at the Thames. One of the great advantages of a helicopter, instead of having to go to international airports where you don't see anything, you can actually go right there and land right in the middle of it.
Dick gave himself a good rest in London before the long leg to Australia, which was just as well, given his state of mind.
Looking back on it now, I just can't see what was wrong with me. But when I finished that first leg, I thought, crikey, I'm not going on. I just didn't want to go on. the wonderful magic carpet ride had sort of disappeared because of the bad weather. But sitting around, spending some time with my family, motivated me to go on. One of the reasons I wanted to do the flight from London right through to Australia was that one of my heroes was Bert Hinkler, who in 1929, in only 15 days, had flown a little tiny aircraft over the same route. And I wanted to see if I could match that time.
Just near here, in fact, I'm at Biggin Hill, but Bert was just over at Croydon, not very far away. There was the same ground mist on the morning that he left for Australia, and I'm going to now leave on the second leg of the voyage and try and follow Bert Hinkler's route.
Well, that weather was so bad, you can probably see it down there, the fog. I couldn't actually talk on the camera when I was departing. Very, very low fog. I just got through it, remaining visual all the time. And so it's now to try and get through to Paris. Bad weather to Paris, I've been told, but possibly good weather from there on. So let's hope that's so. Well, I've sighted the coast. I don't know if you can see it there. It's very, very murky right in the distance. Just bring it up a bit. Just the coast of France just near the Dieppe, I hope. Wonderful. I've actually crossed the English Channel. It's great. I might have some good weather and I might get through to Rome.
I was soon to learn what European weather could be like, because instead of seeing beautiful Europe, all I saw was fog the whole way. Absolutely nothing until I got to the Alps.
He couldn't see and he couldn't communicate either. The French traffic controllers preferred to speak their native tongue.
Well, I'm very fortunate because I've just managed to clear this hill, you can see. I'm actually at 7,500 feet. And as you notice, I'm just in my shirt. It's nice and warm outside. In fact, it's very, very pleasant. But there's some beaut mountains down there.
When the weather was good, no one had ever seen the world in a way that I'd seen it. Because a few hundred feet from the helicopter is just like nothing else. Just absolutely fantastic. I knew no one had ever seen the world in this way before. Because they hadn't. Simple as that.
Dick wants to fly around the Leaning Tower of Pisa. More language problems. Until a listening American pilot helped out.
The sun's so hot, it's just coming straight at me. And as I get down near the equator, I'm going to have to get a proper hat in here because the helicopter's open at the top. And it's going to give me sunstroke if I'm not careful.
Dick hoped to fly from Rome to Athens non-stop, but headwinds forced him to come down for more fuel. And then the Greeks had news for him.
As I was flying into Athens, one of the slight problems happened. They wouldn't let me come into Athens airport until 6 o'clock at night, and I had no fuel to wait that long. Luckily, I managed to land a little outlying island and get approval to fly right into Athens as if I was a jumbo jet.
Well, it's another day and I'm heading across towards the island of Crete over very nice conditions. In fact, I'm doing about 130 knots at the moment, about nearly 150 miles per hour, because I've got a tailwind. As you can see, the water's very smooth. By the way, you'll probably notice my full uniform on, my Qantas badge and my stripes, because when you're working in these international airports, coming in and trying to get refueled, if you don't have a uniform on, it's almost impossible to get something done. So that's why I'm all decked up like this.
One of the things which I appreciated with flying over the Middle East was that I wasn't allowed to film. And this gave me a bit of a rest because I'd totally underestimated the workload. Suppose what I couldn't get over is only a couple of weeks before it was minus 20 degrees in the cockpit flying across the northern Atlantic. And here I was, it was over 100 degrees, incredibly hot. I had some water in the back of the helicopter, but I could see below that if I'd come down, especially if the radio wouldn't work, and I was delayed, you'd probably only have 1 or 2 days before you could die of thirst.
Well, I'm about halfway across the desert, and I've got this great long track just going and straight across the map. Absolutely dry, wouldn't be a place to come down, be very nice at all.
After Egypt, where Dick has been driven mad by difficult officials, the Saudi Arabians seem quite indifferent to his arrival. They ignore his radio calls, but later on he's arranged to find one sympathetic listener.
Well, I'm over the desert of Saudi Arabia, but I've got a great way of telling if there's any cloud up ahead. Listen to this. Qantas 2, could you tell me if there's any cloud up ahead at all?
Delta into Kilo, Qantas 2 looks clear from what we can see at the moment. There seems to be some low-level haze, but the visibility appears to be quite good, and there's no cloud for the next 200 miles anyhow.
Roger, can you see right through to Muscat, do you think?
Negative, not quite.
I'd set myself such an incredible workload, which I'd underestimated. I had a camera to talk to, I had a still camera to take photographs with, I had air traffic control to talk to, I had to try and navigate, as well as keep the aircraft into the air. It made me pretty tired, but when the weather was good, it was really worth it.
Well, once again, it's over the sea again. In fact, I'm crossing the Arabian Gulf now. You can see that it's not too bad. It's pretty rough down there on the water. Might be a bit hard to see because I'm way up at 3,500 feet. When I actually get to India, which is not going to be very far, just across the Arabian Sea, up to New Delhi, I'll be one halfway around the world. I don't normally drink, but I'm going to have a glass of champagne when I get there.
I'd read every book I could about Amy Johnson's flight to Australia, and she'd mentioned this incredible mountain range on the southern coast of Pakistan. Flying over it was a bit like flying over the moon. And to think that Amy Johnson, just over 50 years before, had flown exactly the same place and commented about it.
Well, I don't know if you can see me, but I've just departed Karachi very early in the morning. You can see the clouds just going past there. And below us is the Indus River, straight down below. But it's very, very early, and in fact, I got away before dawn, really, and the sun hasn't yet peeped over the horizon. I've got to depart just as Bert Hinkler did, right on first light, to be able to get right through on all the legs. Oh, look, there's the sun just coming up.
But in India, everything caught up with me. 10 days of flying with hardly any sleep, just the sheer frustration, the incredible high temperatures. I found that I couldn't even get the calls through to my family. It was just the final straw. I was ready to give up.
Well, what a pity it is I just can't show you what has to go on the ground. These forms here have to be filled in triplicate and duplicate. They have to be signed by about 5 different people that you've got to go and search for, and it can take up to 2 hours to do it, just to get a flight plan. Whereas, say, in the United States, all you do is make a phone call, 30 seconds, and that's it. Well, it was only a couple of weeks ago I was at the famous Mississippi River, and now I'm just crossing the Ganges. The famous Ganges River starts off in the Himalayas and runs right down towards Calcutta. In fact, I'm heading to Calcutta now.
One of the things I found that flying by myself, I couldn't discuss anything with anybody. And flying especially over remote areas, I knew that if I came down, especially if I came down in the jungle, that maybe no one would ever know where I ended up, and that worried me. I found the strain was very great there, but once again, when the weather was good, I tended to forget about things like that. I was convinced that nothing could really go wrong, I'd be okay.
Tick has taken a day's rest in Delhi, and now cuts out his planned Himalayan detour to save time and keep up with his hero, Bert Hinkler.
I've just been reading Hinkler's diary, and when he left Calcutta, he ran into some huge CVs, cumulus clouds, and this is the type of thing that generates the monsoon, and as you can probably see, I'm getting into them. In fact, I've got to try and get around this one that's coming up, and I haven't yet worked out, but I'm going to try and get around.
Near Rangoon, Dick makes a memorial flight over the area where a famous Australian flyer, Kingsford Smith, disappeared on a night flight in 1935, also attempting a record.
I found that when I got down into Burma that the weather changed so much to the worse that it was like flying in a waterfall. You could hardly see. The drumming of the water on the front of the cockpit was so loud it was louder than the engine noise.
Dick changes course so he doesn't have to fly blind over the sea, cuts his speed to 40 miles an hour, drops to 100 feet and finds wet sand.
Well, if I look a bit begraggled, I've been forced down on this little beach. The weather is absolutely atrocious. I've been outside, I've been absolutely sopping wet. I had to move the helicopter once because it was right down and it started to turn over as it sunk into the sand.
I could hardly see. I was miserably cold. I was wet. I thought, am I going to be able to continue on with the flight? But there was no way I could get around the world without getting through the monsoons.
To escape the sand needs full power. Dick spends one night in Thailand and heads down the peninsula for Singapore. a lot of the time in poor visibility.
Well, it's now over the rice fields of Malaysia. Beautiful little villages and everything. Let's have a look out there. Really lovely. Well, talk about exciting. I'm just coming up on the equator. In fact, it's just coming down now, within about half a mile on the VLF Amiga, and it's going to change from north to south. Well, the VLF Amiga says that I'm over the equator, and to celebrate, yoo-hoo! Now, on the ship, they splash water around and dunk everyone in the swimming pool, into the sea. Whoa! Oops! I crack you, all the radio equipment will probably stop working. Over the equator, from now on in the southern hemisphere.
He's still 2,000 miles from Darwin and 4,400 miles from Sydney. And to keep up with Hinkler, he must fly Bali to Darwin over 1,000 miles in one day.
But I could be in a problem because the only way I can get to Darwin today is to have virtually no wind. But I'm only doing a roundabout. Let me just see on the Amiga. Yes, I'm down to about 85 knots of ground speed because I've got quite a headwind. And there's streaks on the water down there which show me that the wind is actually running towards me. The sun has just come up, but it's hidden in those clouds. Now, I just sighted the coast of Timor, and I'm coming in to try and find the airport at Kupang to land, and let's hope I don't take too long. If I take any more than about 45 minutes on the ground with the fuel, I won't be able to get to Darwin. I've still got a tremendous distance to go, and the whole flight today, over 1,800 kilometres, which is probably the longest flight a solo helicopter has ever done in one day. Definitely one of these, anyway.
What I'd been worrying about was the longest water crossing of the whole flight to Australia, and that's the big ditch between Indonesia and Australia. But of course, everyone always talks about what would happen if the engine failed. But what worried me more than anything else was losing the generator, because then within 8 minutes I would have lost all my navigational equipment. And the difficulty then of trying to find a small island or a small location would be very, very hard.
Dick has saved time with a very quick stop in Timor before the last 450 miles of sea crossing. He's on autopilot now and almost there.
I've just been listening to the local radio station and it appears that people are already out there to meet me, and I'm getting excited. I've only got 117 miles to go, so what, 15 and a half days since London, it looks if I'm going to make Darwin. I'm really excited. It looks if I'm going to make it.
I was really pleased to have been able to keep up with Bert Hinkler's time. 15 days from London right through to Darwin. To me, I suppose it was almost as good as landing at Balmoral Castle to be there landing at Darwin and seeing my fellow Australians and a great crowd of people coming out to, I suppose, give me the best wishes.
He's back on Australian soil, but he's still 20 flying hours from his home in Sydney.
Look at Sydney Harbour, absolutely magnificent. Oh, I'm proud to be in Australia. What beautiful weather, what a beautiful place, as good as anything I've seen.
Dick was allowed the rare privilege of flying under Sydney Harbour Bridge. Looming over him and his family, the next and most challenging part of the flight.
I sometimes can't quite understand myself because I love being at home. I suffer from homesickness. I seem to have this crazy drive that I've got to get off and test myself. And here I was back in Australia, back with my family. And right at that stage, just to think that I'd have to head off again was just too awful.
He headed off after a refit and a long rest. He faced one major difficulty, Dick would have to refuel in mid-ocean to complete the crossing to the Aleutian Islands and mainland America.
As I set off on the last stage, I suppose I felt more apprehensive because I knew what I'd done and I'd got away with it. But I just wondered how much I could push my luck, and there were some incredible ocean crossings, far longer than I'd ever done before. I knew I'd have to have a bit of luck, and I was worried, but I just wanted to try and finish the flight.
Imagine that I'm on. Haven't had time to check the camera. Out across the harbour bridge that I came down underneath on the way in, and heading off for the last leg.
This is the kind of weather Dick is used to. It's now autumn in Australia. His schedule is arranged so that he'll be flying in the Northern Hemisphere in the spring. It won't be in conditions like this, but at least it will be possible to fly. Dick left Australia at Cape York, 1,500 miles north of Sydney, and headed across the sea towards Irian Jaya, the Indonesian part of New Guinea.
Well, I've sighted the coast. Here it is. I've crossed Torres Strait. I suppose you could say this is the first major water crossing of this leg of the trip. Not a very hospitable place, you can see. Mud.
Irian Jaya, at last it was the first true wilderness. After flying two-thirds the way around the world, I'd finally seen something which was true wilderness. No roads, no people, no buildings, absolutely nothing at all.
Dick was grateful that another helicopter pilot from a local mining company had arranged to guide him over the featureless jungle.
I'm following John there and the other JetRanger ahead of me, constantly communicating and keeping with him, because you wouldn't want to be flying in this area with no experience of being here before. It'd be very, very dangerous. In fact, we're going to have to get down below this rain and go right down onto the valley floor.
Indonesia, which Dick had flown over on his way south, includes about 13,000 islands in its long chain. Dick is heading for the Moluccas, the Spice Islands, and is crossing the equator again in what he insists was the wrong direction.
Yep, there it is, zero all the way. Fantastic. The equator, everything now north, and back to the United States, let's hope. Wonderful. The southern hemisphere. You can see how much nicer it looks. Oh, yeah. And this is the northern hemisphere. Look, there's all this rain here. Ah, well, and straight ahead I've got these very big CBs, huge thunderheads, and I might just be able to get through those showers. I've got to be very careful not to fly under them. Look at that big one out there. It's a beauty.
Of course, the wonderful thing about a helicopter is you can get down low, and I call it sort of fun flying, where you can see absolutely everything. People wave at you friendly. At any time, you can land on a beach if you want to, maybe grab a coconut and eat it.
I'm just flying up on the island of Mindanao in the Philippines. Of course, the Philippines are made of thousands and thousands of islands. And in fact, I'm at 6,000 feet, which is about the highest I've been since I was in Greenland, crossing the ice cap. This mountain up here, obviously an old extinct volcano, is about 9,000 feet high, and I'm heading for a little pass, which I hope to be able to get over, and that's about 5,500 to 6,000 feet, so I might just be able to get over it. Oh yes, over the top we come. Fantastic. I've got no idea what's on the other side. Wonderful.
After a night in Manila, the 450-mile crossing to Hong Kong.
Well, my dream has come true. Another one of my dreams, Hong Kong. This is the other side of the island. I'm about to turn around and come right down through the harbour of Hong Kong. Fantastic. The Statue of Liberty, the Leaning Tower of Pisa, the pyramids, and now Hong Kong Harbour.
Over the years, I'd done dozens of business trips to Hong Kong, and here I was flying over the Star Ferry in my own little helicopter that I'd flown all the way from home.
As he left Hong Kong, his VLF navigator behaved erratically, and he was forced back to basic navigation to find Japan.
What a welcome. I've got helicopters absolutely everywhere. They're just out there. They've just asked me if I want to fly around the Tokyo town. A lot of smog around, but I'm going to have a go at it. Fantastic. Oh, here's one just coming up here.
Six helicopters escort Dick into Tokyo, their pilots recognizing perhaps another kamikaze flyer.
Talk about lucky. I've only just landed at the Tokyo helipad after flying around the Tokyo Tower, and here I am down at Yokohama, and the Hogue Marlin is just docking. That's the ship, the huge ship that I'm going to try and land on Saturday. It's Tuesday today, so I just hope that the weather's going to be good and that ship's in the position so I can land on it. We're about to load on the 44-gallon drums of fuel and also to put the radio equipment on board. Well, this is the main hatch cover deck of the Hogue Marlin, where I'm going to have to land. In fact, I reckon I've found the exact place that I'm going to want to land, and here it is. This little mark here, 5. I want to be able to put Delta India Kilo right over there.
Dick will leave Japan at Kushiro, and he'll be forced to skirt the Russian prohibited zone. He hopes to find his moving ship after flying for about 6 hours. If he spots his target before he's out of fuel, his next stop will be the Aleutian island of Shemya. He is taking a risk most pilots will call insane. As Dick prepares to leave, the weather is no better than moderate. He takes with him the minimum of possessions to lighten the helicopter, and adding an extra tank, he fills his machine with a special fuel which will give it a range of 1,200 miles in good conditions. He puts on special clothes, which might keep him alive if he misses the boat.
Being back in survival suit reminds me of crossing the Atlantic, because it's the only place since I've worn it. But heading off from here towards Alaska, it's going to be awful cold if I come down the drink, and that's why it's on. I've got about 690 nautical miles to go to the ship, and if I find the ship okay and I can land on it, then it's another couple of hours of refueling from drums and then to try and get right through to Shemya. But that's going to depend on the weather, of course. On the map here, there's an area which is the Asian coastal buffer zone. That's so you don't fly over the Russian restricted area. But I'm going to have to fly through the buffer zone, even though the Japanese have told me that the Russians will probably scramble their fighters or even try and shoot me down. But I don't have enough range to go around their restricted or the buffer zone and get right up to the ship. So I'm just going to have to take the risk and go through here. I can't really imagine that they'll try and shoot down a little helicopter.
Of course, if I'd known that 2 months later a Korean jet was to be shot down, there's no way I would have taken the risk. I wouldn't have done the flight, and I wouldn't have been able to complete the world flight.
To add to his difficulties, Dick's tanker was in and out of fog, and he was above cloud.
The problem was that after flying the 700 miles from Japan, I wasn't heading for a big country. I was heading for a tiny ship that was moving, and I had to find it, because if I couldn't find it, there was no way I would have ended up anywhere than in the ocean. I almost felt sick. I can remember sitting there in the cockpit, freezing cold, and thinking, what am I doing this for? But luckily at the time, the weather was just okay, and I managed to get to the ship. But looking back on it, I was incredibly lucky, because to do such a long journey, over 1,400 miles in one day, in a tiny helicopter, over water the whole way, with only one engine and no floats, well, you've got to have a bit of luck to be able to get away with it. I'd never landed on a ship before, but that wasn't too bad. The biggest problem was the refueling. I'd only allowed about half an hour to refuel the aircraft, but because the ship was rolling and the fuel was slopping out, it took over 2 hours. And the problem was I still had 7 hours to go to try and get to the tiny island of Shemya, and I knew I couldn't get there after darkness. There'd be just no way I'd get in.
It's 700 miles to the American airbase at Shemya. Then the worst is over, because on the way to the mainland, Dick can use the Aleutians as stepping stones.
My impression of the Aleutians was remoteness, exceedingly remote. No roads, no people. There were wrecks. You could see that people hadn't been on the islands and on the beaches probably for 20 or 30 years.
Making the way up the Alaskan Peninsula, and I've just sighted the first trees since leaving Japan. No trees on the Aleutian Islands at all. Let's have a look. See them down there, some pine trees, the first ones I've seen. Well, this is where I've got to be very, very careful. There's a big mountain coming up ahead, and it gives the impression that you should go straight ahead, but in fact I've got to come slightly around to the left of that mountain, otherwise I won't be able to get across the pass. Getting a bit bumpy now, and the clouds are starting to come in, but I'll just keep going and go as far as I can go. It doesn't look too bad.
And I was unprepared for the quick change in weather, where you'd sometimes be flying in good sunlight, and within 20 or 30 minutes it would suddenly deteriorate to really bad weather, and you couldn't see at all. And I remember my muscles would tension in my stomach. I'd start to feel, well, a bit sick inside, and that's when I'd start to wonder, what am I doing this for?
I'm just going to get over the pass, I think. Huge glacier here. Very wet and rainy, and I might just be able to get through here. Bit of fog. Not very nice flying, very, very marginal. Yes, I think I'm through. Yes, I can see the glacier now at the other side. I'm through. Wonderful. I managed to turn and get through the cloud, and I just hope that as I turn around here I should be able to see Mount McKinley. By crikey, there it is. Right up above the cloud, I'm up at 10,000 feet, and that mountain's still another 10,000 feet above me.
Another man might have flown south from Anchorage, anxious to reach a gentler climate as soon as possible. Dick had actually turned north, to visit America's highest mountain.
Just so fantastic here. I'm going to see if I can find a place to land on the ice and get out and have a look at the glaciers. In fact, I've just found a nice little ridge down here. I'll see if I can get down here. Well, I'm on the ground, or I should say ice, safely, so I think I'll get out and have a bit of a look around, see what it's like. Pretty cold and pretty icy. What a magnificent place this is. I can actually see hear huge lumps of ice breaking off the glaciers, and you can actually see the ice coming down. It's spectacular. Little Delta India Kilo back there, just a dot. And right around I've just got magnificent mountains, magnificent glaciers.
A man-made addition to the landscape, the Alaska Pipeline, dipping underground so animals may cross.
Well, the junction of the Klondike, which I'm on, that's the mighty Yukon up there to the left, and down here to the right, the town of Dawson.
Once a violent gold rush city. There are now only 25 flying hours between Dick and Fort Worth, the end of his record-breaking journey.
When I planned the flight, I never really thought I'd complete it. But as I started to get across the United States, I thought, crikey, I'm going to finish this. I think I was more surprised than most people. And the excitement started to rise, the weather was good, and I suddenly realized I'm going to become the first person to fly solo around the world in a helicopter.
Fantastic! Ha ha! I'm in Texas! Wonderful! Gotta watch out for school buses unloading. It says here the maximum legal speed limit. Oh, it doesn't mention helicopters. Well, I'm very excited because I've just pulled out this last map which brings me into Fort Worth, and there was my track when I left nearly a year ago, tracking out from Fort Worth towards England. So to be back on the same map that I was using, oh, you've got no idea how happy I am. Only, about 200 nautical miles to go. Really fantastic. I'll keep this map forever.
On his solo flight filming round the world, Dick has logged about 315 flying hours, flown 37,000 miles, and has never been at a loss for words.
Well, talk about exciting. In fact, there's a helicopter up there. I don't know if you can see it. Bell have sent a helicopter out to me. I'm just flying along now the main interstate highway and heading only a couple of miles to go. Talk about...
Gear 2-1 Sierra Romeo, clear land to Mayport.
That's the Bell control. I'm here, the Bell factory's coming up, fantastic.
HDIK, roger, cleared across the field on a right-hand orbit is approved, sir. Wind is southeast at 5 knots.
Ah, roger, it's good to be back.
Okay, welcome home.
Thank you.
Sir, Delta India Kilo, you're cleared to land. The wind is indicating 150 degrees at 05, and they'd like for you to park up there just to beam of that red line where the people are standing.
Roger, I certainly will.
I did the flight really for purely selfish reasons. I wanted the challenge, I wanted to see if I could do it. And I was, I think, more surprised than most people that I actually finished it.